Okay, in this semester we start discussing about marine fisheries, and this is going to be an introductory lecture on marine fisheries. And in this lecture we primarily discuss about the importance of marine fisheries and the support to blue economy and blue growth, and FAO fishing areas, exclusive economic zone, and the global marine fisheries production. And then we discuss upon the major references to be followed. Okay. And first of all, we start discussing about the importance of marine fisheries. And when you discuss about the marine fisheries, primarily we have to discuss about the food security which is provided by the marine fish. So the current issue of the human society is that there is an enormous challenge to provide food and livelihood to a population which is well in excess of 9 billion. By the middle of 21st century. And also, if you look at the environmental issues, climate change and the environmental degradation, it primarily impacts the resource base. And when you look at the future developmental scenarios, for example, United Nations has forwarded a developmental goal, which is called the United Nations 2030 Sustainable Development Goals. And it offers a unique, transformative and integrative approach to shift from the world to a sustainable manner and approach a resilient path that leaves no one behind. And the critical importance of fisheries and aquaculture is that it provides food, it provides nutrition and employment for millions of people. And that means if you look at marine fisheries, the connectivity with the livelihood, and this is very, very important. Okay. Now, let us see how the marine fisheries or the fisheries in general are connected with the common people across the world. Then you will understand that almost 3 billion people rely on fish as a major source of animal protein, and which means getting almost 20% of their dietary intake from this source. All these 3 billion people, they get 20% of their dietary intake of protein from this source. And over 3 billion people depend upon marine and coastal biodiversity for their livelihoods. So this is very important when we discuss about the marine fisheries. And let us discuss the key facts and figures with regard to the fish and its role in nutrition. And fish provide, as I said, fish provide more than 3.2 billion people with almost 20% of their average per capita intake of animal protein, and more than 50% in some less developed countries. For example, if you look at some of the island nations, there almost 50% of their protein requirement comes primarily from the fish, because they have no other sources. A primary source will be the fish. And when you look at fish, it is not the meat alone. Sometimes the undervalued parts of the fish, like the head, viscera, and the backbones, they make up 30 to 70% of the fish, and they are especially high in micronutrients. Unfortunately, many times even in the case of small fish like anchovy, what we do is we discard all the skeleton, but the skeleton carry, or the backbone, the vertebra, it carry huge amount of micronutrients. And that means in the case of small fish, we have to include all these in the dietary component. And then fish consumption has increased from 9 kg per capita in nine per capita means per head consumption annually. From in 1991, it was 9 kg, but it has increased to approximately 20.3 kilogram as of today. And over half of the fishery products are designed for consumption originate from aquaculture now. And if you look at this figure, then you will understand that the fish is a major source of different components. For example, if you look at the vitamin A, it's a major source of vitamin A. Then you have the omega-3 fatty acids. Then we have the vitamin D and vitamin B12 and different elements like selenium and iodine, iron, calcium and zinc. So it's actually not only rich in vitamins, it's also rich in minerals and very important components as we discussed in this figure. Okay, so this probably you might have learned earlier, but this is a diagrammatic representation of how the fish play a very important role in supplying different vitamins and essential fatty acids for human beings. For example, if you look at the long chain omega-3 fatty acids, it's mainly found in fish and fishery products, and these fatty acids are essential for optimal brain development. And that is one reason. And look at iodine. Seafood is in practice the only natural source of iodine. And iodine serves primarily for aiding thyroid function, and it also is essential for neurodevelopment. And you look at vitamin 3, another important component in fish. And this is very important for mental development. And this vitamin also regulates the immune system function, and it's essential for healthy bones. And look at another component called iron. And especially during pregnancy, iron intake is crucial so that the mother can produce additional blood for herself as well as for the baby. And the other minerals present in fish, calcium, zinc, and other minerals. And these are again important for many of the developmental processes in the human body. And in essence, if you look at this figure, you will understand how important the fish is in human development, particularly the brain development and development of the neurons and other essential functionalities in human body. Okay, and this figure essentially provides you how much quantity is there in the fish bones. So that means you should not actually waste fish, including the bone, including the other structures other than meat is also very important. For example, if you look at the nutrients available in the tuna bones, 100 kg carry almost 10 gram of calcium, 36 milligram of iron, 8.6 milligram of zinc, and other elements as well. And at the same time, you compare it with maize, which is commonly used as a food ingredient in our daily intake. And you can see that in all the components, it is very, very less. So that is the reason why fish products are ideal complements to starch-based diets lacking these nutrients. And that is the reason why the fish as a food ingredient is very, very important in determining the nutritional security of the human being and as well as the food security in general. Okay. And if you look at the way in which fish consumption is increasing, for example, as quoted by the FAO Director General, since 1961, the annual global growth in fish consumption has been twice as high as population growth, demonstrating that the fisheries and aquaculture sector is crucial in meeting FAO's goal of a world without hunger and malnutrition. That means if you look at the futuristic scenario as well, the fish play a very, very important role, and the growth of the fish consumption has increased tremendously, and it is almost double than that of the human population growth. All these things reiterate the fact that fish is a very important component as far as food is concerned, food security is concerned, nutritional security is concerned. And coming to the livelihood, 10 to 20% of the world's population depends upon fisheries and aquaculture for their livelihood. Okay. And it varies in different continents. For example, it is highest as in Asia, as you can see here, it is almost 84%. Okay. And the total number of fishing vessels in the world was estimated to be around 4.7 million. Okay, these are some general statistics. And 12% of the world population depends on fisheries. And out of that, more than 90% are small-scale fisheries. And about half of them are women. And all these things point towards the fact that even though the percentage of people involved in this is less, but many people in the developing countries, especially in the small island nations, their main occupation is fishing, and their main dietary requirement comes from a fish. And you can see that 40% of the coastal fisheries are responsible for nearly 40% of the world's wild caught seafood. That means globally, if you look at the capture fisheries, almost 40% come from the coastal fisheries, not from the deep sea areas. So that is the importance of the coastal seas across the world. And if you look at aquaculture, 18.9 million fish farmers are there in the world. Out of that, 90% are small-scale producers from developing countries. So if you look at aquaculture and the developing nations, it's actually a main source of employment here. And this is again the statistics from FAO, livelihood and decent work, the main facts. And around 200 million people are employed along on the value chain from harvesting to distribution, of which 59.6 million are directly employed in fisheries and aquaculture. Okay, so the value chain, primarily, you know, when you catch the fish, from the catching process till it reaches the consumer, there are large number of people involved in the processing, in distribution. All this network together represent the value chain. So if you consider the actual fishers who actually catch the fish, and then when they bring it to the harbor, there are people who sort it out, and there are intermediary person, and there are auction agents, and then it will go to the wholesale agent, and sometimes it may go to the processing factory, and they process it, and finally reaches you. And in some cases, if the fish is supplied to your home, it is again carried through different sectors of people. And all these people are part of the value chain for fish. Okay. And then another important factor is women, who account for more than 14% of all the people directly engaged in fisheries and aquaculture primary sector. With the proportion of women exceeding 20% in inland fishing and 50% when secondary activities such as processing are included. That means even if women are not directly involved in fishing, they are very active in other sectors like fish processing. For example, look at Kerala, a large number of women are employed in the fish the processing center, where their main business will be the peeling of the shrimp, etc. So that means their income also come from the fishery sector. Okay. And employment in the small scale fisheries is several times higher per ton of harvest than the large scale fisheries. So in general, globally, the small-scale fishery provide employment in the small-scale fishery sector than in the large-scale fishery sector, and including the commercial fishing. And when you look at the marine fisheries, you also have to understand there are some ecosystem values. For example, marine ecosystem services in particular, it provide more than 60% of the economic value of the global biosphere. That means the ecosystem per se play a very, very important role in providing a large number of services. For example, ocean provides us with 50% of the oxygen we breathe. And the estimate for the value of total ecosystem services from the ocean, estimated in 2014, was around $125 trillion per year. And with some 30% of the world's coral reefs are of value to tourism, estimated at nearly $36 billion, or 9% of all coastal tourism value in the world's coral reef country. So coral reef also provide a very, very important role in getting the income for many countries across the world. And if you look at this graph, then you will understand that the ecosystem, marine ecosystem means the fishes and other animal and plant components, including the microbial components included. Okay, they provide a lot of provisioning services. For example, it provides food, raw materials, biochemical and medical resources, and energy. And if you look at the regulating services, what is the regulating role played by the marine ecosystem? Then you will understand that it has a biological control role and regulation of water flow and the climate regulation, moderation of extreme events like the cyclone, etc. And then supporting services, maintenance of life cycles for many organisms, maintenance of genetic diversity in terms of the biodiversity present in the ocean. And coming to the cultural services, throughout the world, ocean and the marine ecosystems are used for recreation and tourism, scientific advancement, a lot of which we will discuss in the blue growth, and inspiration for culture and design, and spiritual experience. So generally, even though we are not directly using these services, it provide the marine ecosystem per se provide a lot of ecosystem services. This is essential when we think about the blue growth and development. Okay. At the same time, when you look at the issues in the fishery sector, just like any other ecosystem, this is also impacted by a large number of anthropogenic activities. For example, habitat destruction in the form of coastal development, fishing gear impacts, over-exploitation. There is over-fishing, unscientific fishing happening in the ocean. Pollution is another issue, including the eutrophication. And there is an issue of invasive alien species. And finally, the marine ecosystem in general are highly impacted by climate change. That means there are several issues also. And as a result, if you look at this graph of WWF, you will see there is actually high decline in the global fish stocks over the last 50 years, particularly with the marine species. And the impact, as you see, is more in the coral reef ecosystem. So you can see that the impact of human activities in the marine ecosystem is very, very high. That also points us towards some kind of action is also required when we address the marine species harvesting from the system. Okay. And also, when you look at the importance of marine fisheries, you should understand that nearly a third of commercial fisheries globally have already been collapsed. And there is an urgent need to work at all levels to drive commercial fisheries towards sustainability while improving the management of world's small-scale fisheries and aquaculture practices. And if you look at the future, what actually oceans or marine ecosystem provide us and why this is very, very important. And the concept of blue growth envisages further harnessing of ocean for strengthening our economy. That means we have to depend more on the oceans for strengthening our economy, for more income for the countries, and how it is possible. And blue growth, and in many countries, it provides job, it provides more value in terms of the resources, and also it provides a lot of opportunity for sustainability. And if you look at the areas, primarily, we start with aquaculture, because you know there are limitations as far as land areas are concerned, so we naturally have to depend upon aquaculture, especially marine aquaculture, heavily. And there will be more opportunity for improving coastal and marine tourism. This is also very important. And biotechnology, as you are aware, there are large number of international projects called drugs from the sea. Lot of life-saving medicines are coming from the oceans and the marine organisms, and especially the antimicrobial, anti-cancer, antibacterial agents. And all of them ultimately will determine the health of the planet in the years to come, and as well as the health of the human being. And renewable energy in the form of tide, in the form of wind, and in the form of other forces in ocean, all provide the sources for energy. And ultimately, the mineral sources, which we have not yet started exploring in a larger scale. So ultimately, sea is again a source for all these things. So all these five sectors will, in future, provide a lot of the economic security for many of the maritime nations across the world. And that is the reason why many countries across the world, they now think about blue growth and blue development, and means a growth, a kind of development, economic development, strongly based on ocean and ocean resources. So if you look at the future, again, we need to have a stronger orientation towards ocean. And it is believed that it will provide more employment in terms of coastal tourism, in terms of shipping, because when there is a lot of traffic congestion happening in the terrestrial ecosystem, more transportation is going to happen through the ocean, and there is more employment in terms of fisheries, in terms of aquaculture, and in terms of oil and gas exploration, in terms of offshore wind, tapping the energy resources, and ultimately there is huge potential for exploring sustainably the mineral resources, particularly in the seabed. So all these things offer a lot of scope when we discuss about the future of the ocean. Okay. And this is a very interesting document, which I have provided a link to at the end, which you can download and use. And this document provides the examples how better we can harness fisheries and aquaculture, especially when we think about the blue economy and blue growth. So particularly when we look at the future, by 2050, we need more and more resources for sustaining the economic development of the population, as well as the food security of many of the nations in the world. Okay. And that is the reason why the government has, the FAO has forwarded a concept called Blue Growth Initiative. And Blue Growth Initiative primarily is concentrated on fisheries and aquaculture. It supports the livelihood of millions of people around the world in rural and coastal communities, and often play a key role in a society's culture and identity. But when the population grows, the demand for fish increases, and our natural resources are increasingly under pressure. Sustainable management and development is crucial to preserving and preserving these resources for future generations. Like green economy principles that preceded it, FAO's Blue Growth Initiative emphasizes the three pillars of sustainable development. That means economic development, environmental development, as well as social development. Okay, so that is the reason why all these things form part of the 2030 Sustainable Development Goals, where also the fisheries and aquaculture play a very, very important role. And this is the Blue Growth Initiative is a strategic approach to improving the use of aquatic resources, resulting in better economic, environmental, and social outcomes. Okay, and this is the major initiative, Blue Growth Initiative. Ultimately, it aims for three kinds of development: sustainable development, three pillars, economic development, environmental development, as well as social development. And this is a conceptual diagram. How will you maximize the blue growth concept, sustainable development of fisheries and aquaculture? So we can see that there is a kind of environmental benefits when you have the ecosystem functioning in a proper way, managed judiciously. Definitely the environmental benefit will increase. For example, if you are increasing marine protected area, definitely the ecosystem services will increase. And similarly, maximizing economic growth. So that means if you are harvesting the marine resources in a judicious manner, sustainable manner, definitely the income for the people also will increase, especially for the fishermen community. And social development, because you know a society will develop when the society is happy and society has its own economic standing. And all these things come when you have a proper plan for the blue development and blue growth. Now, this slide discusses on the division of the global oceans, mainly for the purpose of collecting data for FAO. And accordingly, already we have discussed about the inland fishing zones. For example, if you look at the Asia, the fishing zone number, inland fishing zone number is 4. At the same time, and this kind of a division is done primarily based on the, some biogeographical elements and primarily for the intention of collecting data in a sustainable manner and based on the peculiarities of the oceanic parameters. And in that sense, if you look at India here, you'll see that in the oceans nearing India, it comes under two FAO fishing zones. For example, this part, which is west to India, and this part is Indian Ocean. And you can understand that this is the Western Indian Ocean. Western Indian Ocean is the FAO fishing zone number 51. And if you look at the east part of India, including the Bay of Bengal and Andaman Sea here, so you can see that this part is actually Eastern Indian Ocean, and that is number 57. Okay. So when you look at the marine fisheries in India and look at the FAO statistics, you should understand that in India, we have two FAO fishing zones or fishing areas, and one is 51, which is the Western Indian Ocean, and second is 57, which is the Eastern Indian Ocean. And as you can see, these are the major fishing zones across the world, and the name you can see on the right side, it's from the Atlantic, Pacific, and Arctic and Antarctic, what are the major fishing zones across the world. And these are the inland waters, which we have already discussed. And this is the other areas, Atlantic Ocean and adjacent area. And we have Indian Ocean, already I said, fishing areas 51 and 57. And then we have the Southern Ocean, Atlantic, Indian Ocean in the Antarctic region, and the Pacific in the Antarctic region. and specifically Pacific Ocean, which is one of the highly productive zones in the world. And when you focus on the India, you will see the focused areas 51 and 57, two fishing, marine fishing areas, FAO, marine fishing areas. And all these areas are further divided into subzones. For example, if you look at the area, the entire area is actually the FAO fishing zone 51. And 51 is again divided into 51.1. For example, this area, this is very important. This is the Red Sea area. And if you look at two, and this is called the Siberia, Gulf of Siberia. And then if you look at three, this is called the Western Arabian Sea. And if you look at the area close to the western, west part of west coast of India, you can see the fourth component, and this is the Eastern Arabian Sea. And then you look at the fourth component, this is the Eastern Arabian Sea. Third component, this is the Western Arabian Sea. And fifth component, it is very close to Somalia, Kenya, and Tanzania, and that is the region. And sixth area, you can see an island. This island is called Madagascar. And this includes Madagascar and Mozambique Channel. And area number seven is the oceanic area. And then eight is actually the Mozambique. Okay. So you can see that each fishing zone or fishing area is further divided into subzones. So in accordingly, the Western Indian Ocean area has seven subzones. Okay. And similarly, if you look at the Eastern Indian Ocean, this is divided into six subzones. For example, you look at the area very close to India, Bay of Bengal. This is the Bay of Bengal area. And then second is the northern area. And this is the central Eastern Indian Ocean. And then you will see the fourth area, the oceanic area. And 5.1, you will see the Western Australia. And 5.2, you will see the Southern Australia. And you can see the Western as well as Southern Australia here. So you can see the Eastern Indian Ocean, the area number 57 is further divided into six subzones. And this is primarily for easy facilitation of analysis as well as compilation of data by FAO. So these divisions you should understand. Now, before we go into the global scenario, you should also understand how the sea is classified into different zones based on United Nations Convention on Law of the Sea. And you can see that one is territorial sea. As you can see, this is a territorial sea, and territorial sea is actually 12 nautical mile from the baseline of a coastal state. Within which the state can exert control of its laws and regulations. So this is the territorial sea, 12 nautical mile area. And this is immediately followed by another area. You can see territorial sea, close to territorial sea, there is an area called the contiguous zone. Here it is 12 nautical mile, the next 12 nautical mile. So altogether 12 plus 12, it is actually this 12 nautical mile. 12 nautical mile. So together 24 nautical mile from the baseline of the coast. And this 12 nautical mile adjacent to the territorial area is called a contiguous zone. Okay. This is the outer edge of the territorial sea in which the coastal state can exert limited control over its laws. And the third component is very important in terms of fisheries. And this is called exclusive economic zone. And this is called EEZ. Okay, so you can see if you start from here to here, this is an area, and this area is about 200 nautical miles. And a maritime zone extending 200 nautical miles, which is approximately 370 kilometers from the outer edge of the territorial sea, in which the coastal state has specific rights over the exploration and the use of resources. Traditionally, so if you look at this area, the territorial sea in India is actually under the control of the state, various states, maritime states. But in India, generally, the exclusive economic zone, 200 nautical mile area from the baseline, this is an area where the country has the full authority over the exploration of marine resources. Marine resources, it is not only fish, but also include the minerals and other resources available in the area. So this is something very important about exclusive economic zone. And then you will hear, came across a terminology called a nautical mile. Let us see what is a nautical mile. So nautical mile is actually a measurement which is used in the ocean or in the larger aquatic ecosystems. And this is like just like the kilometer which you use in the terrestrial area, or meter. Okay, it is used usually by the symbol M or NM. NM is the commonly used symbol. And this is actually a unit of length that is about 1 minute of the arc of latitude measured along the meridian, or about 1 minute of arc of longitude at the equator. By international agreement, it is 1,852 meters. That means approximately 6,076 feet. So this is the only thing you have to remember. One nautical mile is approximately 1,852 meters, or 1.852 kilometer, and approximately 6,076 feet. So that's a nautical mile. So in ocean, this is the measurement of distance. And see, if you look at India here, so whatever is shaded with a deep orange here is our exclusive economic zone. Okay. And if you look at this exclusive economic zone, this is 2.2 million square kilometer. So that is an area which is the exclusive economic zone of India. Naturally, if you have other nations close by, so there will be overlap, and this overlap definitely will be finally discussed between the nations, and then they come to the boundary, the maritime boundary. Okay, so if you look at India alone, then you will understand, see, all these shaded areas here represent the exclusive economic zone in India, and we have the exclusive economic zone around the Andaman and Nicobar Islands also here. Okay, so India has about 2.2 million square kilometer area all along its 7,500 kilometer coastline. Okay, so that is very important. The exclusive economic zone of India is 2.2 million square kilometer. Now, we will come to the global marine statistics. This is the latest report available from FAO. And this report is called the State of World Fisheries and Aquaculture. In short, it is called the SOFIA, State of World Fisheries and Aquaculture. Okay. And now, let us see what are the major points discussed here. And you will understand that the total, this graph will tell you the story in the last 65 years of history, fishing history, and what is the trend in the global captured fisheries. What you see here in the orange shade is the captured fishery, and what you see here in the turquoise blue shade is the cultured fishery. And if you look at the global production, and you can see that captured fisheries see at static right from 1980 onwards, and at the same time from 1980 onwards, the contribution of the captured fisheries all over the globe is almost static. At the same time, year after year from 1980s, you can see there is increased contribution of aquaculture. So this trend is going to increase in further periods also, and probably we can see in the near future the aquaculture production will overtake the captured fisheries, because there is more demand for fish, and naturally we have to increase the aquaculture production to meet the demand, increasing demand. Okay, now let us see what is the total production. Total global production in 2016, according to this data, is 171 million tons. And here aquaculture contribute 47% and captured fisheries contribute 53%. And this data is excluding non-food purposes. For example, we use fish for making the fish meal, fertilizer, etc. And that quantity is excluded. And this data is only the fish which is consumed by the human beings. And if you look at the data, this is 171 round of total world fish production, fisheries production. Out of that, as I said, the captured fisheries is 47% from aquaculture. That means 80 million tons. And 53% is the contribution of captured fisheries, which is 90.9 million tons. So this is a general scenario as of 2016 data. Okay. And if you look at this graph, then you will slowly understand that the share of aquaculture is again increasing year after year, and also the contribution from aquaculture. And at the same time, there is almost a stabilization of the captured fisheries production across the world. Then our topic of discussion today is the marine fish production. And if you look at the marine fish production, you can see that it is almost stabilized. And the last year in 2016, it shows a slightly declining trend also. And in 2016, the total global captured fisheries production was 79.3 million tons out of 90.9 total captured fisheries production, including inland. So if you take marine alone, then the production is 79.3. So that means in captured fisheries production, the marine component is dominant compared to the inland component. So major part of the production globally from the natural water bodies, it's represented by marine fisheries. Okay, so that is the importance of marine capture fisheries. So this is a status. And if you look at the total global fish production, you will understand that you know, the some of the fishes dominate. So that means when you have a total data of 81.2 million tons in 2015 and 79.3 million tons in 2016. And you can see that some of the fishes dominate in the catches. And the dominating fish, as you can see here, is one fish, and that is called the anchoveta. It's also called the Peruvian anchovy. And the name is, the scientific name is Engrolis ringens. So Engrolis ringens play a very, very important role in the total global fish production. Okay. And now let us see which are the three species which dominated the marine fish catch globally. And the most important fish which peaked the production, captured fisheries production, is the Alaska pollock. And the second position is for anchoveta, the Peruvian anchovy, that came second. And third is the skipjack tuna, and that is the third position. So these are the three species which dominate global marine fish catch. And coming to their scientific name as well as the classification, this is Alaska pollock. Scientific name is Thyregra chalcogramma. It is a bony fish belonging to the order Gadiformes. It's also called cod, and it belongs to the family Gadidae. And it's present in the North Pacific. It grows to a maximum length of 91 centimeters. And the second fish is the anchoveta. This is also called a Peruvian anchovy. And the Peruvian anchovy, if you look at the scientific name, it's called Engrolis ringens, and belongs to the order Clupiformes and the family Engrolidae. And this species is limited to Southeast Pacific. And this is very common in the Peruvian upwelling zone. Okay. And third fish, which is common in India also, Indo-Pacific species, and this is called skipjack tuna, and scientific name is Catsuonus pelamis. And it belongs to the order Perciformes and the family is Combridae. And it's a marine pelagic oceanic fish, cosmopolitan in distribution, growing to a maximum of 110 centimeters. So these are the three very common and most dominant marine fish in the marine fisheries globally. And I am not going to read all this list. These are the 10 species which actually dominated the cache. Already we discussed about the Alaska pollock. Then we have the Peruvian anchovy. Then skipjack tuna, and then followed by Atlantic herring and Pacific chub mackerel. Then yellowfin tuna, Atlantic cod, Japanese anchovy. Then European pilchard or sardine, and then large head hairtail, blue whiting. Atlantic mackerel, Sardinella's knee, and Scad's knee. And these are the 10 species which dominate the global marine fish catch. And in terms of nutrition also, the fish, marine fish play a very, very important role. In per capita terms, food fish consumption grew from 9 kg in 1991 to 20.3 kg in 2016. That means the average rate of about 1% growth per year. And so you can see that globally the annual fish consumption is increasing throughout the world. So that is again a scenario. And in 2015, fish accounted for about 17% of the animal protein consumed by the global population. And fish provided during this period about 3.2 billion people with almost 20% of their average per capita intake of animal protein. And you can see that highest intake is some island countries where their main food source is fish. For example, in some of these small island developing states called SIDS, it is over 50 kg, the annual per capita consumption. Okay. And in the Central Asia and in some landlocked countries where fish is less available, there it may be 2 kg. So there's huge difference in the consumption pattern of fish across the world. And when you compare small islands with the landlocked countries. And employment, we have already discussed. Most recent official statistics indicate that 59.6 million people were engaged in the primary sector of capture fisheries and aquaculture in 2016, with 19.3 million people in aquaculture and 40.3 million people in fisheries. And the proportion of people actually employed in capture fisheries decreased from 83% in 1990 to 68% in 2016. It is an indication that, you know, the number of people primarily engaged or employed in capture fishery sector is slowly decreasing year after year because of many reasons, including non-availability of resources and also shift to other employment opportunities, etc. Okay. And in 2016, 85% of the global population engaged in the fisheries and aquaculture sector was in Asia. 85% was in Asia, followed by Africa, where it is 10%, and then Latin America and Caribbean, where it is 4%. So you can see that almost 85% of the global population engaged in fisheries comes from Asia. And that is the importance of Asia with regard to fisheries, global fisheries. And it is estimated that in 2016, overall, the women accounted for nearly 14% of all people directly engaged in fisheries and aquaculture, primary sector, as compared with an average of 15.2% across the reporting countries in the 2019-2016 period. Okay, that means 16% of the people are, 14% of the people are directly engaged in the fisheries and aquaculture primary sector. So altogether, there is a number is considerable when you look at the employment also. Okay, and here we'll discuss only one point. The fishing fleet, total number of fishing vessels in the world in 2016 was 4.6 million. These are the fishing vessels, right from small boats to commercial level fishing vessels. And where also Asia is highest, it's almost 3.5 million vessels, which is almost 75% of the global fleet. Okay. And this is the percentage contribution or total marine fish landing in various countries, marine. And here you can see that China is in top with about 15 million ton of fish production. And India is in sixth position. In 2016, marine fish production from India was around 3.5 million tons. Or approximately, if you round off, it is around 3.6 million. And at the same time, the first place is 15. That is a huge difference between the Chinese production of marine fish and the Indian production. This huge difference. Okay, even the second country, which is Indonesia, it is less than half of China. That you should remember, Chinese production is 15 million tons and the Indonesian production is only 6 million tons. So India in a global listing, India's position is sixth in marine fish production. And these are the species-wise listing, which you can read later. How much is each, the contribution of each species, the topmost species, towards marine fish production in the world. Now, in this graph, you will see which are the regions that contribute maximum. Okay. And if you can see this graph, this region, which is marked with a ring here, number 61. And this region is called the Northwest Pacific. And the contribution from this area is around 22.41 million tons. And the next one is Southeast Pacific, which is only 6.33. So you can see that if you look at the entire global areas, FAO areas, 61, the area, fishing FAO fishing area number 61, which is Northwest Pacific, it contributes 22.41 million tons. It's, you know, the second one is Southeast Pacific, which is only 6.33. So that means the maximum fish production in the globe, marine fish production, it comes from the Northwest Pacific. So this is the most important fishing zone. And you can see, say, well, the Indian Ocean region, Eastern Indian Ocean is 6.39 million tons, and the Western Indian Ocean is 4.93 million tons. Okay, so if you are asked about the fishing zone, fishing area which contribute to maximum to global fish production, it is area number 61, which is Northwest Pacific. Okay, so you can see that the trend, you can see the tropical areas. If you compare the temperate area, which is the cooler waters, then tropical waters, which are the warm water, and the upwelling area, there is a very interesting statistics, especially in the last 40 years. And what is the trend? You can see that in the tropical area, the fish production is slowly increasing. At the same time, once the highest fish production actually came from the upwelling area. Upwelling area, as you are aware, are the areas where there is a phenomenon called upwelling, where the cool, nutrient-rich water is carried towards the coast and it comes up, and so that, you know, the coastal waters are rich in nutrients. It facilitates the production of plankton, and naturally that area facilitates huge pelagic fish production. But that is changing in the last 20 years especially, and the reason is climate change. So as a result of climate change, there is the pattern of upwelling is changing, and as a result, the production and also some other oceanographic reasons, including the development of the oxygen minimum zones in many areas, total fish production from the upwelling areas is coming down. But if you look at 1970s, the maximum fish actually throughout the world, it came from the upwelling areas. At the same time, if you look at the tropical areas, the fish production is coming up. Okay. So all these things are pointers towards the changes which is happening in the ocean, particularly due to climate change. Now, this graph tells you the story about what is happening in the fish stock in the marine ecosystem. And you can see the data from 1974 to 2016. You see that the amount of overfished resources, this is increasing. And you can see that the fraction of fish stocks that are within the biologically sustainable level has exhibited decreasing trend from 90% in 1974 to 66.9% in 2015. At the same time, the percentage of stocks fished at biologically unsustainable level, it increased from 10% in 1974 to 33.1% in 2015. So all these things shows that there are overfishing happening in the oceans across the world, and the fishing is happening beyond the maximum biologically sustainable level. At the same time, the underfished resources are again coming down. So that means the scenario is not very good. It's very bleak. And the reason is that there is overfishing and there is biological overfishing happening at many levels. So that is the reason why some kind of intervention is required when you look at the marine fisheries. Most of the populations, commercially available fish, are overexploited, overfished. At the same time, they are biologically not sustainable. That means there is no chance that they can recover the stocks unless and until you go for some kind of sustainable management of resources. And so already we discussed about the nutritional value of the fish and how it contribute to the nutritional security of the people across the world. Okay. And at the same time, you look at the global aquaculture fisheries, and the aquaculture production is slowly increasing year after year. So this is the trend which is at present there globally. Okay. And if you look at the futuristic scenario, what will be the future of marine fish production? And if you look at the futuristic production, then you will understand that by 2030, this will be the scenarios. One, world fish production, consumption, and trade are expected to increase, but with a growth rate that will slow over time. Despite reduced capture fisheries production in China, world capture fish production is projected to increase slightly through increased production in other areas if resources are properly managed. That means there are some underused resources, especially in the offshore and deep sea. And if in every country started exploiting these resources, slowly the marine fish production can enhance if it is properly managed. And then expanding world aquaculture production, although growing more slowly than in the past, it is anticipated to fill the supply-demand ratio. That means by 2030, there is going to be a sharp increase in aquaculture production, and that means we are slowly going to fill the gap between demand and consumption by enhancing aquaculture production. And the prices will all increase in normal terms while declining in real terms, although remaining high. That means the fish, the value of the fish, the amount you have to spend to purchase the fish is going to slowly increase. Okay. And it will remain high. Okay. But sometimes the value available for the fisherman may decrease, but the value of the fish is slowly going to increase. As you can see, that's a recent trend also. And the food fish supply will increase in all the regions, with the per capita fish consumption is expected to decline in Africa, which raises concern in terms of food security. So this is a projection for 2030. The projection shows that in Africa, the consumption rate is going to decline. It may be due to the lesser availability of resources, and of course, technically incompatibility to tap all the maritime resources available. So this is again a scenario. And trade in fish and fish products is expected to increase more slowly than the past decade. But the share of fish production that is exported is projected to remain stable. So that means the fish production and the fish products trade is expected to increase slowly. Because only if there is production, then only we can trade it and export it. and the growth will be relatively slow. But the share of fish production that is exported is projected to remain stable because there is more demand, internal demand in every country. For example, if the internal demand, domestic demand in India is very high, then naturally it will impact the export of the products. So that kind of scenario is there throughout the world. Okay. So what we discussed today is primarily on the global scenario with regard to, we started explaining about the general features of marine fisheries, how it contribute to the livelihood security, nutritional security, as well as how marine ecosystem in general will provide the values for the mankind. That is the first part. And second part, we discussed about the exclusive economic zone and the different fishing area, FAO fishing areas across the world, specifically area 51 and 57 around India. And third, we discussed about the current global marine fish production. What is the trend now? And the trend indicate that the aquaculture production is increasing. At the same time, the marine capture fisheries production is almost stabilizing. And at the same time, in futuristic scenario, we discussed, and the futuristic scenario also show that there will be an increase in the marine fish production. But there is always a kind of precautionary approach is needed. Especially when we start exploiting marine resources, because unless and until we go for sustainable use of resources, and the resources will not be available for future generations also. So in this part, you have a few references which you can refer. Two publications, already I told you, the FAO SOFIA report, status of fisheries and aquaculture. And second, achieving blue growth. This is, you can refer primarily to see how the marine resources will ultimately help in strengthening our blue economy. And there is an FAO site specifically on India, how what is the status. And the documents can be downloaded directly from the FAO site. And there is also a book, which of course you can read. Which is a recent, the 2020 publication, which will provide you a brief outline and introduction to fisheries. Thank you.